It's a great pleasure to give this talk in honor of Kolya and to be here. And I can't tell you the story. I better tell you stories about Kolya at dinner. But I would like to say that I met Kolya when approximately the same time as Zhen Hua met him when I came to Harvard. And then somehow I follow Kolya's step, because then Kolya moved to Berkeley, and after some time I moved to Berkeley, and then Kolya has a child, and I also had a child, and it goes like this. So I always go after Kolya, follow his step in a way. And I learn a lot of wisdom about him, and I would say that it is not true that Kolya is disorganized. He just knows how to separate important things and not important. And I also tried to learn this from him. So what I'm going to talk today is recent work. It's supposed to be posted very soon with Siddhartha Sahi and Salmazian, and it's about superalgebras and the Capelli eigenvalue problem, which is a very classical problem. So as an introduction, I'm just going to remind you what it is. So you can see it, right? It's a little bit, hopefully, yeah. Is it okay? Okay, so we will start with reductive Lie group or Lie algebra, but we can put superalgebra at this moment. It doesn't really matter. And we consider a spherical representation of this algebra, superalgebra, or in other words, it is multiplicity 3, which means that if I look at the ring of regular functions on this representation, it is a direct sum of reducible representations. The set of weights run, this is just the set of parameters which parameterize irreducible representations, and each appear with multiplicity 1 or 0. So, and we consider the algebra of polynomial differential operators on this vector space V. And the task really is to study the algebra of G-invariant polynomial differential operators. So in this case, it's really very easy to do, because if you look at, so this is just a Weyl algebra built on the representation V, and if you look at it as a representation over G, that it is a product of symmetric algebra of V and V star. And so, therefore, we have such a decomposition here. And we want to look at invariant operators, which just means that we just take G invariants here. It's going to be, right, we have only, those are just forms from V mu to V lambda, so here we have, we can just apply Schur lemma, and we get that we actually get a basis. We get a basis in the algebra of invariant differential operators. And this basis is coming from intertwining between V lambda and V lambda. And this basis is called Capelli basis. So now if I take I lambda, an element of this Capelli basis, and I look how it acts on this particular sub-representation in the ring of regular functions, when it acts as a scalar. But this scalar now depends on two parameters, lambda and mu. And in fact, one can show, and it's not very hard, but if I look at C lambda mu as a function of mu, this is a polynomial. This is a polynomial function. And Capelli eigenvalue problem is actually basically for different situations like this, study these polynomials. And it happens that these polynomials are give very nice and interesting basis in the ring of symmetric polynomials, or more generally different cases of McDonald's polynomials arise in this way. So I think, if I'm not wrong, that the first business was started by Kostant and Sahi, where they proved that a certain situation when you actually have two copies of gel N acting on a space of matrices by multiplication on the right and on the left, then this corresponding the corresponding polynomials are just shifted symmetric polynomials.
So it's only for this particular case.
Yeah, this is for particular case. Yeah, I didn't write it down, but yes. And then they were studied by Andrei Okounkov and Arshansky. For example, yeah. So in this case, they depend on the partition, and then they are uniquely up to rescaling, they are uniquely defined by the certain vanishing property. So lambda and mu partitions and phi lambda of mu is zero unless lambda is a subpartition of mu. So in other cases, because you have many cases of spherical representations, and if I'm not mistaken, Victor was classifying them, right? Victor classified these representations. And you can get different answers, but you always get some nice interesting polynomials. In particular, this is something which was developed later by Knop and Sahi, and independently by Okounkov and Anshansky. Those are called shifted Jack polynomials. And now those are the polynomials which depend on the parameter theta, which is just a complex number. And they give a new basis in a set of symmetric functions. This basis again is given, is determined uniquely by this vanishing condition. The ratio of lambda is certain normalizing parameter. I'm going to define it later.
So it's independent of theta.
Huh?
It's independent of theta.
It's not independent of theta.
It is dependent on theta. Oh, wait. Ah, this thing doesn't depend. I think it doesn't depend on it, unless we'll see later. I'm not completely sure. Yeah. Sorry, I think it is not, but the question is H lambda in super case, it depends on theta, but I'm not sure.
There's this kind of like length and arc.
Length of arc, yeah.
Length and arc
is separate,
yeah.
But when we go, it depends on theta, right? So I should put theta here. There is a formula later on in the slides. And on the other hand, these Jack polynomials are eigenfunctions of Calogero-Moser, Sutherland operators, and they play also important role in some integrable systems. So now I'm going to talk about more recent work of Sergeev and Veselov, where they generalized this theory of Jack polynomials to the case of super Jack polynomials. And now, if before they were variable, they depend only on one set of variables, x1, xm, that now depend on a double set of variables. And in a way, this is closely related to so-called hook partitions. So these hook partitions are, so you fix two numbers now, m and n, and you consider the diagram which can fit into this hook. So you can see the Young diagrams which fit in this hook, or equivalently, you say that this box is forbidden in your diagram. And this x1, xm, and y1, yn, you can think about it as you really define them as Frobenius coordinates of your partition. So on the other hand, if you think it is clear that this HMN, this hook partition, enumerate polynomial representations of a supergroup or superalgebra, JLMN. And so that is clear that somehow These polynomials must be related to Capelli problem in the super case. So that probably was the starting point of this project with Sahi and Salmazian. So we basically studied Capelli eigen problem, and in a nutshell, the result is that the polynomials which appear in this case as an eigenvalue polynomials are either Jack polynomials, shifted super Jack polynomials for different value of parameter, or they are other kind of symmetric functions which are Q-Schur functions and which are also very interesting functions appearing they are special set of MacDonald polynomial. And what we get here are so-called factorial Schur polynomials, which previously also was studied by Ольшанский, Okounkov, and Ivanov. On the other hand, this second set of polynomials, which we are going to introduce later on, they appear in representation theory of the supergroup Qn, which is a sort of the analog of GLMN in this Schur-Weyl duality in the case when instead of representations of symmetric group, you consider projective representations of symmetric group. And I'm going to remind it later. So now I'm going to basically to give the details on these two results and maybe even go further for applications. But let me start, since I'm not supposed that everybody here knows what are the superalgebras, but I think right now a lot of people know. Just briefly, let me remind you a couple of things about this. So if we work in this category of super vector spaces and we consider a finite dimensional vector space, which has a Z2 gradient, then we have, like in the classical case, we have symplectic group, orthogonal group, and general linear group. And here we have the same thing, slightly different, although. So first of all, there is this group GLMN, which is just the group of matrices. Actually, the algebra, sorry, the superalgebra of matrices with the given commutator. So this is the first thing. When we can assume that our super vector space equipped with canonical operator, odd operator, which changes the parity such that square is the identity operator. And when you consider this algebra, superalgebra, of operators which commute with this odd operator pi. And then there are two analogs of orthogonal symplectic group. Namely, we can also assume that our vector space E is equipped with symmetric form, or Q-symmetric form. And this Q-symmetric symmetric form is non-degenerate, but it also can have even. It could be even, so it also has a degree, and it could be even, or it could be odd. And depending on that, you get two series of classical Lie superalgebras and classical Lie supergroup. Now, as the combinatorial object which appear in our work are either hook partitions, which depend on two parameters M and N, or strict partitions. So I'm going to explain in the next two slides how they appear in representation theory. So if you try, if you take this group Lie superalgebra GLMN, and you can play the same game as you do in the usual classical Schur-Weyl duality, you just take the diff tensor power of E, and then you have a decomposition. Like this, where S land of E, this is so-called Schur functor, and this is irreducible representation of GLMN. And the multiplicity space is an irreducible representation of the corresponding symmetric group. So what is the difference? The difference is what is the set of partitions which appear. And if in a usual case, if, for example, n equals 0 in the usual case, you just have a partitions with m rows. And you just take this sum of the partitions with m rows. And here we take all partitions with d boxes, all Young's diagrams with d boxes, which fit into the hook. But now I can play the same game of Qn. This is actually very beautiful. Now already classical result of Sergeev. If you work with Qn and play the same game, then what you have to do, you have to calculate a centralizer of Qn here. And so there is a symmetric group action, as before, symmetric group action x here. But also, you have the action of this odd operator p, and it is and it acts on h and each term in the tensor product. And so this is your decomposition in this case. And the space, multiplicity space, is actually the reducible representation of this centralizer, which I denoted here by ud. And this is a smash product of group algebra, of symmetric group. And the Clifford algebra builds onto with d generators. And interesting thing is that this ud is Marit equivalent to the group algebra of this double cover of symmetric group, if you assume that the center acts by minus one, so quotient by z plus one. So, and that gives you the duality between projective reducible representation of symmetric group and representations of polynomial representations of Qn. And it is not very difficult to see that in this case, these representations are described by the strict partition, not just all partition, but only the strict partition. So now we are going back to Capelli problem. So this crash course on Lie superalgebras is finished. And the first thing is that we do not have such a classification of all possible spherical representations at the moment. Actually, my student now working on it, and it is possible to do. But at the moment, we don't. And we won't just, where we're discussing, we started this project, we were thinking about what is a good source of examples of these spherical representations. And it come up, and again, it is related to Victor Katz's work. It is related to so-called counter-Kohler-Tis construction of Jordan. I put here superalgebras, but of course it's also true for algebras. So here is a setup. You start with a Lie superalgebra, and inside it you consider, you assume that you have embedding of SL2. So you have a standard SL2 triple inside. But you assume you have, this is called so-called short SL2 triple, meaning that the only weights of H are 2, 0, and minus 2, and that's only. And so if I have, and that defines on this big G the Z gradient. And for the small g, and this is our main object here, we take the zero part of this gradient, which is again a superalgebra, and then this first G1, the grading term G1, has the structure of the Jordan superalgebra, defined just in this simple way. And in a way, you can go back. If you start with a Jordan superalgebra, say simple Jordan superalgebra, you can build a simple Lie superalgebra. Since I'm not going to use it, I don't give here any details of this contraction, but so after Victor classified simple Jordan, simple Lie superalgebras, he did simple Jordan superalgebras. And why it is important for us? Because almost always this V, this Jordan superalgebra, is in fact a spherical representation of G. And even more, if you take this canonical element E of an SL2 triple, which is identity element in your Jordan superalgebra, And this canonical, if you look at this orbit, it's an open orbit. Inside your supervector space, you have an open orbit, and this open orbit is a symmetric superspace, and it's going to be to play a role later on. So, and then there is a list, and we're just going to look at the list and see what kind of Capelli eigenvalues we are going to get. So I divided this in three groups. So one is related with this classical superalgebras. So this is exactly super analog of the situation considered by Kostant and Sahi when you have GLMN, and there are two copies of GLMN, and they act on the left and right of the matrix space, which is the tensor product of two standard representations of two copies. When we have as V, we take the symmetric square of the standard representation of GL M to N, and then we have the one which is related to so-called quadric, projective superquadric, and in this case V is just a standard representation of GOSP. And GOSP, this is the notation for the center, the central extension, trivial central extensions of our orthosymplectic superalgebra. And by the way, I should say that in all cases, when we define this little g, which is just the centralizer of H, H in it is going to be central element, so it's always the central element. And in another way, I think I can say that this is a Lewy subalgebra and parabolic subalgebra here. So anyway, as I said, almost always V is a spherical representation of G. And I say always, but here is the case where it is not. So here I should look when in this third case, when we have multiplicity free, and it happens exactly if the superdimension of your space is either positive or odd. Now that's the condition. And we also have certain exceptional cases. There are two exceptional cases which appear here. One is interesting because this is a deformation. This is the deformation of some simple superalgebra. So it never happens in the classical case, but it happens in the super case. So there is so-called D21T. This is one parameter family of superalgebras. And so if I look at G, this is GL12, but if I look at the space, its highest weights depends continuously. So there is a continuous parameter in the highest space, and this is T. And the last case, this is F13, is really honest, exceptionally superalgebra. And I don't know what I could say that in this case, this Jordan algebra has dimension 6-4, even bosonic dimension 6, fermionic 4. And second case is spherical, and the first is spherical for the special value of parameters. And then we have this one, which I discussed, P and Q. And here we also have two possibilities. And again, in this case, both cases are spherical. So basically, these are all the cases which we consider, and they all come from Jordan superalgebra. And so now I'm going to go to superjack polynomials. So, and I'm going to remind you what they are. So we take two set of variables, x1, xm, and y1, yn. Those are vector variables are denoted by bold. And we ask that our polynomials are invariant, are symmetric on x's and on y's. And then we have additional symmetry condition. And this additional symmetry condition depends on the parameter theta, because this superjack polynomials, this is a family, and it depends on the parameter theta. And here is, this is the condition. Whenever xi plus theta yj is zero, that means that I can add 1/2 to xi and subtract 1/2 of yj, or do vice versa, and I get the same value. And this is a new symmetry condition, which cannot be described in terms of action of any group. So if theta equals 1, what we get is usual supersymmetric polynomials. And these supersymmetric polynomials appear in many ways, and they are very important. So first of all, there are invariant polynomials in the joint representation of GLMN. And they have a basis of super Schur polynomials as lambda of xy. This basis is enumerated exactly by Hooke partitions, all Hooke partitions, H, M, N. And they are basically the characters of corresponding polynomial representation. So they are complete analog of Schur polynomials. But what is different about this ring is the usual case, the ring of symmetric polynomial is just a polynomial ring. But in the super case, this one is not finitely generated. This subring in the ring of polynomials is not finitely generated, not necessary. Okay, so now this is a preparation for the definition of this shifted superjack polynomials, which is very particular basis inside the ring of all superjack polynomials. So what is given here, these are Frobenius coordinates. The Frobenius coordinates given by this formula here. So the point is that when you look, okay, so when you look at this Hook partition, then in reality you should cut your partition in two. So there is the upper part and the lower part over here. And Frobenius, this shifted Frobenius coordinate, just measure the distance to this green line. It's written for the formula is written here. And this green line has an angle theta. Okay, so the tangent.
Angle or slope?
Slope, thank you. Slope theta. So basically what I want to do, I want to parameterize partitions just by x and y's, so I can get the polynomials here. So here is this h theta, and you see that it really depends on theta. Yeah, here we are. And this is just normalizing parameter. At least in my talk, it doesn't play important role. So anyway, so suppose C, so this is a theorem which was independently proven by Sergeev and Veselov and Knop and Sahi, that if you take a complex number, which, and this is important, is not negative rational, when for each Hooke partition, there exists a unique polynomial P lambda x, y, theta, here, which satisfies this properties. First, the degree is not greater than the size of the partition. Then, and this is the so-called vanishing condition, which is very similar to what I formulated before, plus, and this is just a normalizing condition. Right, so it's just the scalar here. So this family of polynomials form a basis of this ring of superjack polynomials, and they are called shifted superjack polynomials. Okay, questions here? Well, so that's what we did. We just look at all these cases. So remember, it is in three groups, and the first two groups are served by superjack polynomials. So in each case, this Capelli solution to the Capelli eigenvalues problem, you remember, this is just which polynomial give you eigenvalues of Capelli basis. So here we are. So it depends. So they are all given by this basis, shifted superjack polynomial, but the parameter is different. So the parameter depends. The parameter depends, and well, here, so the point is that you write down that you V lambda is, okay, so you have this. But a priori, this lambda here is, say, the set of highest weights, and this is not a set of a partition. So In fact, each time we use certain trick to identify this lambda with certain set of partitions, certain hook partitions. And it is written here what we have to do. So for example, in this third case here, you see theta really varies of this super dimension. Remember, I told you before, the super dimension couldn't be negative. And indeed, if theta is negative, then we don't have this super, shifted superalgebraic polynomials are not defined. And this representation, the corresponding representation, regular representation in Rencontres functions, it is not completely reducible, not multiplicity free. So it's somehow this parameter sees it. Here you see we have minus 1 over t. So because this one, if you remember, is related to this d2 1t. And in the last case, theta has parameter of theta is 3/2. So this is just a result of calculation. If you remember, there is two other cases which are related to this so-called strange superalgebra, P and Q. And for this, we have to consider this Q symmetric function. So let me give you the definition first. Here it is. Oh no, sorry, Q, not Q. Symmetric Q functions, okay, symmetric Q polynomials. So what they are? Those are, this is again a subring. Now, this is a subring in the ring of symmetric polynomial, and it satisfies the additional property. So since it is symmetric, I'm only wrote it for the two first variables. But the point is if xi plus xj is zero, then you can, then you have this additional symmetry here.
And it's a correlated to all reflections.
I will talk about it later, okay? About odd reflections, not here. Okay, so three facts which useful to know. So first of all, so you see, this is a, what is written here is like Newton polynomials, but they work only with odd degrees because only odd degrees satisfy this. And so they generate this ring, but it is infinite, okay? So there is no such thing as you can, so basically there are super traces of the matrices and you cannot express a super trace of any part of the matrix in terms of the previous one. So they are generated, but they, you cannot take finitely many of them. You have to take all possible cases, so odd Newton polynomials.
So is it Noetherian?
No, it's again not Noetherian because of this reason. All these supersymmetric polynomials are not Noetherian. It's kind of test. So, oh, sorry, excuse me. So SQN is isomorphic to the ring of invariant polynomials in the coadjoint representation of QN. Remember before, usual supersymmetric functions. They were invariant polynomials in GLMN, and this one are invariant in for this supergroup QN. And we also have Schur functions here. And these Schur Q functions, they appear in McDonald's book. They actually hold polynomials when Q plus 1. So they are well known to people before even this superalgebra Q appeared. So Ivanov, 99 or something, he actually built the basis of, I think also Andrei and Grisha Alshansky, they also studied that, but I think this characterization by vanishing property belongs to Ivanov. And so here, basically we do the same thing. We construct a new basis in the space of Schur. In a space of symmetric U functions. And this is the vanishing condition. This is normalization condition. And this is degree. The second one is the vanishing condition. So if your mu, the size of mu is strictly or less than lambda and mu is not equal to lambda, then Q lambda star on mu equals zero. Here we don't need Frobenius coordinates. So our, this is just the usual, your partition is identified with x, lambda 1, lambda n is x1. So this is a basis and it is called.
In the previous sentence, you discussing the ordering of what?
No, I am discussing what does it mean with q lambda star of mu. Mu is just mu 1, mu 2, mu n. Okay? And so here, in this case, this is the last two cases of the list, we get as a solution to Capelli eigen problem this factorial Schur Q functions. Okay. So I would.
Last condition. Why do you need the last condition at all?
A priori, I don't. I mean, so my guess is that if you want your polynomials to have integer coefficients, you need this normalization. At the moment, I don't know. For us, it is not important. We can rescale the things. Or at least I don't see importance of this, but probably it might show up later. So here is my favorite example. So I remind you that if I take GLNN and I consider second symmetric square of the standard representation, but change the parity. And this is very important that at this moment I change, in super case, I can switch the parity. Then I have this identity. This is specifically so symmetric, dissymmetric power of pi of x is exterior, this exterior power of x with suitable change of parity. And therefore, if I would like to decompose C of V, I can use the classical result. And that's what I'm going to get. But now here, the set of partitions for S lambda of E star, they are so-called quasi-symmetric partitions, which built out of, they're almost symmetric, but not exactly. So the point is what you do, you take the hook whose horizontal length is a little bit bigger, by one box bigger than the vertical length. And you build the partition out of them. For example, something like this. Or you can even put here. So you have like three hooks here. But of course, and so those are really representations which appear as summons in the regular case in this in the space of functions here. And of course, in fact, you can just take a half of the partition and you get exactly the strict partition, right? So what you can do, you can just do this. How do you do it? Wait a moment. Yeah, if you take off the diagonal, what is left up is going to be the strict partition. So you have a bijection between this quasi-symmetric partition and strict partitions. Okay, and that's how it happens, how we get. So look what we are going to do. The thing which I didn't talk about yet, that if I take universal enveloping algebra of our Lie algebra, when the center acts there by differential operators, polynomial differential operators, and it really gives you x on C of V. These are differential operators, just the differential operators, like Laplacian operators. And so you have a homomorphism of algebras. And in this situation, it is surjective, okay? So now what is this? This is like invariant polynomials. So those are really superjack polynomials with a parameter set equals one. But when I apply phi, and this is just a calculation, a very simple calculation, I get exactly these super Q functions, depending on that. So if I go to this particular, so I know how particular Laplacian acts on the highest weight representation here, and so I just plug in. Okay, so I already know the symmetry condition. What it remains is a vanishing condition of Ivanov. But the vanishing condition in the case of Capelli problem is trivial. Because basically, when you write down your differential operator, you will see that it annihilates all polynomials of small degree. And that's all you need. So you actually don't need to prove it. As soon as you realize which particular set of partition you have to work with. So here, yeah, so I mentioned that at some moment here I use the surjectivity of this map. Even in the classical case, this map is not always surjective. So here in our list, which we so far we understand, The surjectivity only fails in one exceptional case, which is related to this exceptional superalgebra F13, and we have to use some other trick to prove the symmetry. In all other cases, we can use the symmetry of the Harris-Chandra homomorphism, and we do restriction. And when we do restriction on a particular set of weights, we get new symmetry conditions, which are different. So here is a general remarks about the proof. So first, we have to identify lambda with certain set of partition. The proof of all these results, but we really get ex-Capelli eigenvalue problem, these classical polynomials, which appear in other parts of mathematics, basically. Superjack or shifted superjack or factorial Schur Q functions. So the main point here, but this we have for free, basically. This vanishing condition we have for free. And symmetry condition sometimes is tricky, so it's case by case work so far. And now I'm going to actually switch and talk a little bit about link to work of Sergeev and Veselov on deformed Calogero-Moser systems, integrable systems, how these superjack polynomials appear as integrals for Calogero-Moser systems in the supercase. So, and I'm going to start with actually my result, which is kind of very old, 90 or something like this. So at some moment, Victor has a classification of finite dimensional complex simple list superalgebras. And there, among them, if your superalgebra has a form, it has a root system. And the usual case when you teach real algebra course, how you do it, okay, so you reduce the problem of describing all root systems. So you have an abstract definition of a root system, and you can build out of it. And you can do the same in supercase somehow. So and this is the notion of generalized root systems. So you have a vector space, you have non-degenerate scalar product, but not positive definite anymore. This is not Euclidean. And you have the parity, which is a map. So this delta must be R. This is a set of roots, I'm sorry. So on the set of roots, you define the parity. So one point is, I would like to make it clear, but the root system is completely even. The root system is completely even thing. It's nothing odd there. It's just the set of vectors in the Cartan subalgebra. In all cases we consider, the Cartan subalgebra is purely even. So the main difference is that now we can have isotropic roots, the roots whose scalar product is zero. So those are the axioms of this system. So the first one says that if your root is not isotropic, when you still have a reflection and R is invariant on direction of all these reflections, and if alpha is isotropic, then this is somewhat strange condition. So if I have two roots and one of them is isotropic, and I forgot to tell one important thing, something is missing here. The scalar product of alpha and beta, I'm sorry for this, alpha and beta is not zero, because otherwise it's not true. But if alpha and beta is not zero, in addition to this second condition, then either alpha plus beta or alpha minus beta is a root again. And this is all you need, and then you can prove, you can classify this irreducible root systems, and you get exactly all root system of basic simple least superalgebras.
So, I missed the condition.
In the condition two, alpha beta is not zero, and just I forgot to type it. Okay, so I didn't know much of application of this result, but somehow Sergeev and Veselov made a lot of out of it, which was kind of surprising. Maybe I should tell here, because this is a point where I can tell a story about Коля. So we can ask, what are the symmetric polynomials in this case? So we have this, what I call even reflections. So we have this as alpha, as soon as alpha is not isotropic, we still have reflection, we have a wild group. But for the symmetry in supercase, this is not enough. And we have addition of something which is called old reflection invariance, which if x and alpha 0, and alpha is an anisotropic root, your polynomial is actually constant along in this direction. And when I was talking to Kolya, I remember still in Harvard, I said, this is not enough. There is no group. And he said, okay, then it should be groupoid. And indeed, it happens that he was absolutely right. And you can actually define something like wild groupoid, where you have an automorphism part, usual wild group. So you have like a lot of loops, but you also have odd reflections, which are morphisms in errors in groupoid. And if you have this, then you have this Harish-Chandra restriction theorem, that if I take polynomials on G and restrict it to H, and I take when this restriction map defines an isomorphism between invariant polynomials on G and the ring of these supersymmetric polynomials, polynomials satisfying these three conditions. And now, Sergeev and Veselov, they sort of considered first Calogero-Moser root system, which are related to this usual root, generalized root system I defined. We just abstractly took this definition and built out of it operators and built out the integrable system. And then they say that we can have more. We can have deformed one. So here is their definition of deformed root system. So the, again, I'm very sorry. This should be R again. Delta should be R. So I... It's empty. I'm sorry. Because later I needed Laplacian and if... Okay, so then we have... So what we deform? So the affine structure is the same, just a set of vectors. They deform the form, and they deform the multiplicity space. So now we can have something which has complex multiplicity. So the multiplicity roots are deformed. But there are computability conditions. And the computability conditions are the following. In the old case, we have just multiplicity one. This is like in the usual case. Root decomposition of multiplicity of all roots are one. So here, I don't have any physical meaning for the multiplicity. This is just number. So here are the compatibility conditions. Invariant with respect to, yes?
You say new bilinear form, does it replace the old one, or is it an addition to that?
It's an addition. It's an addition, because you still have to remember who are isotropic roots. Because here is the compatibility condition when you deform, this multiplicity of isotropic root must be 2. This is actually not important because you can really all rescale. For example, you can put M of alpha is 2 whenever alpha is isotropic root. And then there is this last condition. Can be not anything because here they have this remarkable condition.
This is some condition.
Yes, this is the condition of the deformation. And then they classify them. And when they classify them, they have this extra parameter appears. So they take generalized root system, and then there is a slight deformation. Deformation depends only on one parameter. And this is exactly this parameter set I was talking about, basically. Yeah, so they classify that. We defined the symmetry condition, okay? So here it is. Again, deformed supersymmetry condition looks slightly different. So it is wild invariant, wild group invariant. And look here. So you take an isotropic root. You take the hyperplane B of x alpha equals 0, when this condition must be true. F of x plus 1 half alpha equals f of x minus 1 half. So how do you get, for example, superjack polynomial?
This is as before, right?
Actually, it is as before, but...
But only on a different hyperplane.
Yes, so you see? Yeah, the point is that if you are an isotropic line, you can move in your direction many times. But here you cannot move many times in your direction.
Unless they are compatible.
Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh. So you still have new symmetry condition. And they consider the particular case. So this is like A-type root system corresponding to SLMN. This one. Now we have the parameter theta. And when you get shifted superjack polynomials, and they prove that they get the integrable system with this respect to this Calogero-Moser Sutherland the operator. So they get the integrable system, and those basically are integrals for this integrable system.
Theta.
Theta is encoded here. Good you asked. So I think theta is k squared. K is a function of theta. If I remember correctly, theta is just k squared, something like this. Yeah. So actually, it could be anything, but they can build only if k is positive, I think. Yeah, you can prove integrability when it is positive. And so when we did what we did with Sahi and Salmazian, I was thinking, what is the relation? Relation is extremely simple, really. So you can construct these multiplicities. So remember, what we get are superjack polynomials for particular variance of parameter theta. So indeed, what is going to happen now, we are going to recall that in our spherical superspace, we have this open orbit, and this is a symmetric space. If you have the symmetric space, you have symmetric pair, exactly like in the first talk by Jasper, you have a symmetric pair, only now it's a superalgebras. You take the maximal total subalgebra in M, and then you can consider root decomposition with respect to this subalgebra. So that means that you take your roots, which are in the whole Kostant subalgebra, and you project them on the roots in A star. So you get a restricted root system. This is a thing which always appears if you classify, say, real Lie groups. And you can do the same thing here. And the point is that in all the cases, the first cases, which are related to superjack symmetric polynomials, we really have these deformed root systems of type AM minus 1, N minus 1, theta. Multiplicity is exactly this multiplicity. Multiplicity could be negative because this is a super dimension of the root space. But they are an integral in our case. And in this way, we didn't check it, but I just don't see what else it could be. If you look at this Calogero-Moser operator, it's nothing else as radial part of Laplacian, because what you get is really a differential operator on A or A star. So this is, so what is A? A is just like a slice. So A is maximal total subalgebra here. Maximal split torus, as you would say, right, for example. And then you get I would like to understand, really check what this is true, but so it's not really the theorem at the moment, but I think it should be true. So moreover, I think, but this fact about the restricted root system, but we always get this deformed root system of Sergeev and Veselov, I think it should work for all symmetric superspaces. Reasonably good. The one which have a Basov decomposition, but yeah, that's a little bit technical. So it would be very interesting to look in more general situation of symmetric superspaces and see if new integrable system can appear in these ways. But you see, I was recently thinking about symmetric superspaces, and I realized that in general, for example, you take G mod K, where K is a fixed point of involution, and you look at the regular functions here. This is an affine supermanifold. So this structure of this as a representation over G must be as complicated as you could imagine. So we were very lucky in our situation, because in a way, we embedded it into as an open orbit in the affine space, and that was very useful. So I think it would be kind of interesting to classify such symmetric superspaces for which we have this sphericity, multiplicity freeness. We have some examples and we have some non-examples, and this is really. And then we can maybe come up to more integrable systems. I think there should be these Sergeev and Veselov systems, but this I didn't check yet. And I think I will stop here. So, Kolya, happy birthday.